Good afternoon, everybody. I will talk in English. It's okay. I know that from this morning it was okay, so I hope it's still okay this afternoon. I know also since this morning that I have 4 minutes to catch your attention. Otherwise, everybody will be sleeping. So I will count after my presentation how many are still here. Okay, so I will talk about open government data. In Switzerland, we have one running project. I will talk about this. But the relation between open government data and archives are many. And I won't be able to address all these questions. And one very recurring question I get about this is why a national archive institution is taking care of the project about current data. And just to summarize the answer, we are interested not only to deliver or to show to our customer the past data, past information, but we think it's interesting also to show and present the current information. And also because this current information will be one past information that we will have to receive in our archives and to be able to manage for eternity. I will address two major points during this presentation. One is about social media and what happens in the open government data landscape related to this aspect. I had initially the intention to be able to show you what we have as social media on our OGG portal, but the portal is currently, the new version is currently under development. It took a little bit more than what I expected beginning of this year when I was asked to make this presentation. So I'm not able to show you a lot of things about that. But I will make an overview of what happens elsewhere. And one interesting point that I was able to identify related to this notion of interaction is that there is a link between open data, and the link between linked data, archival data, and also interaction. So that's my major thesis that I would like to present today. Briefly about the project Open Government Data in Switzerland, it's something that started in 2011. Now in 2015, the Swiss Federal Archives is officially in charge of this project of implementing the Open Government Data strategy for Switzerland. What does it mean to have a strategy? It means a lot of things. So we have 13 measures that we have to implement until 2018. So we have quite some things to do. But one of these measures is to implement an open government data portal. And that's the point here. What could be very briefly said about the objective of an open government data. Very, very summarized way to say it, it's basically to be the single point of trust. That's something very interesting also for an archive. To search for and find publicly available data sets or data sources produced by all levels of the Swiss administration. So we don't talk only about the Swiss Confederation, but the purpose for this project is also to be here for cities and cantons. So that's the basic idea. At the moment, we have two different portals. The current one, which is under opendata.admin.ch. If you want to have a look at that, do it in the next days, because at the end of the month, this portal will be turned off. It will be replaced by a new version of this portal. The look and feel is a little bit different, but there are a lot of similarities. we have information about data sets, we have information about application, we have information about organization who are part of this portal, and that's also a thing that we find again here. Fertian open data set is just because we are testing and we don't have all on these demo version. So it's a very usual way in this open data portal. If you browse on the internet about this portal, you will see very equivalent, not layout, but organization of data. What it means from a very basic theoretical point of view or technical point of view, the portal is, let's say, just a web page or a website. And it's a website with just referencing data sets, files or application APIs on different systems. And what we have to do if we want to implement or to operate such a portal is that we just working on this part here. We are not in charge of the data. The data are belonging to the data supplier, so every administration units have their own data, they curate the data, they bring this data somewhere on the internet, and what we do with this kind of portal is just to make the reference on where this data looks on the sits on the internet. So that's a major added value of an OGD portal, is to be able to identify places on different internet pages where data sets are or sits. I won't enter too much in detail, but basically, as was mentioned, we have two kind of data that we are facing. One is plain files, CSV file, PDF, and so on. I will come back a little bit later on that. And the other way to give access to data for the customers, for the community, is through API to web services. And that's what we see on all the OGD portal worldwide. What are the challenges we are facing when we are we have to implement a successful OGD portal? First, as manager of this portal, we have to identify sources of raw data across the administration. It's not straightforward that the administration say we have nice data for you. We have to sell the advantage of this portal and to try to acquire some administration. We also have to collect metadata about the data set, so the description, title, and different other items. We also have with the data owner to clarify under which term of use this data will be made available. Is it completely free? Can everybody do what he wants about with his data, or are there some restriction that applies? So this kind of discussion needs to be made. And then we have to reference this data set on the portal. And last but not least, if we are the owner of this portal, we have to make sure that there is no broken link to data. So trying to guarantee that all the links that happen appears on the portal are still valid. And I thought many of these activities are, let's say, quite usual for an archive. Identifying source of data, source of data across the administration is what we do as archivists. You know, I'm not an archivist. Usually archivists are doing that when talking with administration to know about what is important information to be selected and transferred to the archive. Collecting metadata is also something very interesting and very useful to make sure that these information are found. Term of use in a certain way is also something which is of interest. Obvious information, classified information, are there some restriction about delays for making this information available. Referencing and guaranteeing data availability at the level of digital-born information, it's really a challenge. So this is also another aspect to show that there are a lot of similarities between what we have to do here for an OGT portal and what is quite usual for an archive. So let me now give you a brief overview of what is about what is done about social media and interaction within OGT portal. In Europe, there is since a few days or weeks, let's say, a new portal which is called the European Data Portal, and which is live as a beta. And it has already 270,000 data sets referred here. And from 67 catalogs, so this means 67 other OGT portal European wide. One of them is our Kuhn portal here, which is mentioned here. So this means there are a lot of different examples of what is done related to OGT and interaction with customers or users. One typical interaction channel is Twitter. We can find that on the European Data Portal. Another example is from data.gov, so your American portal. Another one here from the data.gov FR from the France. Not all these portals have a Twitter. I thought I could find more, but I was a little bit surprised that not all of them have a Twitter account. We at the moment won't have, but it's planned to have one for the next improvement of our portal. That's a typical way for interacting about with the community about what is new, what has been done with data. Another one is about blog and forum. I take just here an example from the data.gov UK, which is a very good let's say target for us to be as good as they are. They have a lot of interaction capability, and one of them or two of them are on the blogs and forums. So it's here also something very useful and very used in this domain of OGT portal. And another type of interaction which is not very usual, or we maybe don't think about that at the early stage, is the application page. In all the OGT portal, you have reference to an application page. And the purpose here is just to be able to collect information about what has been done with these so many hundreds or thousands of data sets that are published or referred on the portal. And it's a good, very good way to have a feedback on what is used and also to make some kind of publicity for applications that have been developed. And that's what we have on our pilot portal, and we will still have that on the future one. Another example here from data.gov 18. So Austria colleagues have also this kind of application page. And that's, I think, a very interesting way to know and to, without going into the way Google is looking at everything and trying to collect information about everything. Here we are on a way that is very open in the sense that people have to claim and say we are using your data for implementing this application, but on the other side they gain a little bit of advertisement for their application. So that's about what exists for on OGT portal for social media or interactions. One challenge we all be facing when we are confronted to a digital archive are long-term preservation and reusability of data. And the next slide here that I will present is about linked data and also addressing this aspect of reusability of data. In open data, we talk also about reusability, and opens mean different things. It means that there is no legal constraint regarding data availability, no charge, machine readability of data, and also the known proprietary formats. And somebody, a well-known person from the internet, Mr. Tim Berners-Lee, developed or promoted this kind of scoring or rating of data sets. And it started with its well-known five-star model. Does anybody knows about this? Or it's new for, okay, there's one, okay, good. it's the idea to say that if we publish data or information on the internet, and if we really want to be able to work on this data with computers, not just read as a human, but having computers taking advantage of this data, if we publish PDF, it's good, I mean, for human. It's really not good for machine. I don't know if you have once tried to extract a table out of PDF and try to make it as a table in your Excel. Interesting once, but second time you really hate that. And that's the point. So it's good, but it's really not enough. So one star. If you publish something as an Excel document, it's better, but it means that one who wants to use this has to buy an Excel license. So it has a price for using this data. Better, but not ideal. The third level is to have this as non-proprietary data, so a very basic CSV file is much better. You don't need to pay anything for reusing this information, and it's available. And there are two different approaches or ideas to make this data even more or even easier to use, to reuse on the internet, and it's what is called RDF or linked data and linked open data at the end. Does anybody know about linked data? So I have a big challenge now, is to explain in a few minutes what is linked data. I suggest that you will get this presentation, that you go on YouTube, which is another social media channel that was mentioned this morning, and that you look at this small video, 3 minutes, if I'm right, that gives you an overview, a very basic overview of what is a linked data. Linked data basically is about a generalization of what we have on the internet. Currently on the internet we have documents. Could be real document, PDFs or so, but a web page could be seen as a document. And you can browse this by selecting an URL and go on the web page and have the information. It's really done for human beings. It's not done for machines, because the layout and the content of web page is so different that there is it's very difficult for a machine to interpret all this information here. Linked data has the purpose to use exactly the same mechanism of the internet of documents, but the idea is that it's a machine who will have the capability to interpret the content of a linked data page. And human is not very, it's not the focus to have the human being as a center of interest for that. Here I show you an archival record on a, let's say, linked data web page. If you type in that on your browser, you get something like that. So it's not a very nice web page that you very much like to see and browse as a human being, but it's a way to publish on the internet all the information regarding a record of a document. It comes from the Stadtarchiv Baselstadt, as part of a project we are working with them on. And this webpage is, as I said, not very interesting, but it has very interesting features. Instead of being a record in a database, an Oracle database somewhere hidden on a server, all the information is on the internet. And if we generate, extend this to all the records we have in our catalogs, we have the database not stored in a database system, but we have the database stored on the internet. And what we can do more here than what is usual on the normal database system is that we can take advantage of these URLs to link information from different systems. Here maybe it's not so easy to see, but on this record related to one document, we make a reference to another database with a GND well-known German database, which is also on linked data, to complement what we have as information with other information which is somewhere else. And that's a basic idea of this linked data. Everything is about links that or URLs which are shared amongst different systems. Who is lost about this information? I'm sure many of you, but if it's new for you, I'm not able to give you a very complete information or explanation about that at the moment. Anyway, I think it's a very important thing for us in the future as archival institution, and for that we made a small project in Switzerland, which is called data.elot.ch, with different institutions, so Swiss Federal Archive, but many other cantonal archives are part of this project, and we try to gain experience about this type of technology. And the relation with OGD is following. If we have data on the internet with this kind of format, we have to make this information available, and OGD portal is the very best way to promote this kind of linked data sources of information. It's very known by the community, it's very well appreciated by the community, and it's the best way to see what happens with this information when the community is using that. So OGD portal, an OGD portal is the best channel for that. And another interesting aspect we heard about the bar camps this morning in the domain of open data, one well-known term is hackathon. There are a lot of hackathon which are organized many times a year. It's a two-day event. It happens usually Saturday and Sunday. And we did one in June, when it was this year, about GLAM hackathon, so about gallery, library, archives, and museum. So all this kind of information which are usually not the one the community of hackers are used to work with. But it was very surprising to see that we had more than 100 people came to this hackathon for a Saturday and a Sunday to work together. So computers, but also artists and historian work together to build something like 20 small applications or mock-up of applications in order to gain some feeling about what can be done with this kind of data. So it was a very big success, and it's also a way to get interaction in this field of our archival information, which is usually not seen as very sexy for most of the computer community. And so that's part of the project we are working in. And as I said, OGD portals are very interested by linked data. So here just an extract of the UK portal where there is a page dedicated to that. And this show at least one thing is that there is still a lot of education that must be done. Some people know about this data, but there are still some things to be done. So it's not so unusual to have introduction pages for this. But if we go to one typical page, what we see that it gets this five-star model, and that there is a way here to access through what is called a Sparkle endpoint to this data. If I come back to this picture, I think we have to extend it by having in the future also more and more linked data here. And here is a picture of very reduced size of all the data sets which is available worldwide regarding linked data, and it's growing yearly increasingly. It's growing. And that brings us to another point, I think. If our data supplier in the different administration units are more and more interested in using these linked data, we will be facing a situation in some years where we will have also as an archive to deal with this data as archival data. And I think it's better here to be involved now for our own interest and our own use with this data instead of just waiting and see what we can do in the future about that. As a conclusion, for us or for me, I see the interest of OGD and all this regarding interaction with our usual customers or content user. I think OGD is here as a good way for attracting new customers. We can either have our data available on our normal web page, but we can also publish the content of our database as raw data on OGD portal. It's a way to gain our potential customers. And I think OGD can also help us. As I mentioned, we have more than 67 examples in Europe of OGD portals that can help us to better manage this interaction capability and to take advantage of the best practice in this field for our usual portals. If we want to interact with partners, I think it's interesting to partners, I think, other archival institutions. We can take advantage of this linked data as one side effect of OGD for interlinking our different catalogs, and I think it brings a much better, higher quality information about archival contents if we are able to do that. And the last point is a about interaction with digital humanities specialists. I think linked data is not for everybody. I don't expect my mother to be able once to do something with linked data. But I think there are a lot of specialists and a new generation of digital humanity specialists who will be born with this kind of technology and who will be able to take the best out of this technology. And here it brings to something I think very interesting, and that will be my conclusion, is that the content of our database, of our catalogs, if on the internet, could be enhanced by third party. The same way as if you have a web page and someone somewhere else in the world say, well, this web page, I think it belongs to the top 10 pages about this topic. It's something that is done somewhere else, but at the end of the day, it's a way to enhance the quality of your page because people is known about know about that. And with linked data, if you have a catalog entry which refers to a specific document and someone studying this for months and say, okay, but here we have interrelation that could be put between this document and different other documents of other archives, it's something that could be put directly on the internet as a linked data links in a way that it enhances the quality and the information about your own contents. That is for me. I thank you for your attention, and I'm very happy to see that nobody's slept.
Französisch auch.
Französisch auch, perfekt. Ich würde sagen, maximal drei kurze Fragen. Wir sind etwas knapp, aber Herr Herrmann.
They are completely separate, and that's really a challenge that all meta information that will be collected and presented on the OGT portal won't be lost once data will be once transferred to the archives as archival data. That's a basic challenge I see, but there is at the moment no real process to make sure that this happens very correctly.
That's the same.